I am so glad that you're here this morning, and I do hope that you're rooting for the Falcons. I can't wait for tonight, and I love Super Bowl. I mean, I love football, absolutely love football. I love the whole game. I love the whole game. And so a couple things. You need to open your Bibles to Romans chapter 15. Let's go ahead and get started with that. Go ahead and pull out your Bibles, turn it on, whatever you need to do. If it's on your phone or physical Bible there, Romans chapter 15. And let me start by saying this. I never wanted to be a pastor. You might find that a little surprising, but I really didn't. My grandpa's a pastor. My daddy's a pastor. And so when I was 17 years old, I was at an experience a lot like this, a church service. And there was a person speaking, and he was talking about the holiness of God. And when I heard about how much God loved me, and how much he wanted to use my life for a purpose. And when I realized that God had a purpose for my life, that I wasn't just here sucking air waiting for him to return, but that he had grace and mercy and he wanted to do something with my life. I wanted to give my life to the Lord and say, okay, Lord, whatever you wanted to do with it. And I felt him, I heard him, not audibly, but just press in on my life that I want you to be a pastor. And I was like, nope, not a chance, no way. There's no way I'm going to be a pastor. Nuh-uh. But I just knew that that's what he wanted with my life. And was I willing to give him my life and do that? And so at the end of the teaching, the pastor said, if anybody wants to come up to the front, we're just going to dedicate this area. And if anybody wants to come up here and just pray, you can stand here and kneel, but they're going to close with a song. And so I was like, all right, we're going to go down there and we're going to deal with this, Lord. And so I went down to the front of the room, and I remember standing down there, and I was going to have like a contracted deal with the Lord. Like, okay, I am not being a pastor. I will do this and this and this and this. And all I really want to do, Lord, is tell people about Jesus. That's it. That was the contracted deal. And as I'm down there on my knee, I'm down there down a knee, and I'm praying to the Lord, and we're working this out. You know what I mean? I'm going to tell people about Jesus, but I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to do this. And all these, this gentleman, brother in Christ, older gentleman, come up behind me and put it, say, Pastor John, or I wasn't Pastor John then. He said, John, he said, can I pray for you? And I didn't want him praying for me because I didn't want to tell anybody that I was called to be a pastor. And so I said, I struggle with swearing. I struggle with cussing, which was still true. And so go ahead. And so he went and he prayed for me about that. But I was like, okay, Lord. And I made a deal with the Lord that I wasn't going to be a pastor, but I was just going to tell people about Jesus. And that's what we started doing in our very beginning in our ministry, Danielle and I. And that's what we've been doing. And when we felt God tell us, I want you to start a church, it's all because we wanted to tell people about Jesus. That's really what this whole church is all about. And it's been 6 years now, and it's been a church that loves God and loves others, and we want to share that love, the life-changing movement of Jesus Christ, and how when you invite Jesus into your life, it changes everything. That's what God does. He comes into your life, and he just makes it amazing. And I couldn't live without Jesus, and I knew that I didn't want my friends to live without Jesus. On your next steps guide is a little white. W, can you pull that out for me? I want you to be praying about this because when you came in, you saw those were the people that we were going to invite next week to our friend day. It's going to be so exciting. I want you to write a name on there. Who are you bringing with you? Who is it that you're going to say, I want them to know Jesus like I know Jesus. I want them to experience life change. This isn't a pyramid scheme for you. This is an idea to say, how can we share Jesus with as many people as we possibly can so they can experience his life change? And I appreciate Tyler and the creative team, and they're changing the stage. They're getting it ready for next week. We're going to have a brand new series called Lion Chasers. How many of you have a dream or a passion or a vision for your life, and you're just saying, okay, what am I supposed to do with this? And maybe sometimes when fear and we have lack of faith and it comes in, we just set those dreams aside. I believe God has given you a dream or a passion for something, and he wants you to chase those dreams. We're calling it Lion Chasers because I think there's a 500-pound dream in your life that God wants to enable you and empower you, and he's calling you to chase. And so I can't wait. I'm not going to go into it now, but I just cannot wait for next week. You're going to want to be here, and we're going to start it all. It'll be a perfect friend day. You're going to bring your friends, and like Danielle said, our kids took invitations to everybody in their class. It's going to be good. All right, Romans chapter 15. Let me tell you about Paul. Paul is probably a hero to me in the scriptures. I love reading about Paul. I mean, the guy has just one focus, and that's go make disciples and tell people about Jesus, and he's going to do that wherever he can go. This is how you start a church. People ask Danielle and I, how do you start a church? Well, you just start sharing your faith with people. You start telling people about Jesus, and their lives will forever be changed, and they're going to want to tell people, and they're going to want to tell people, and they're going to want to tell people. That's how God works. That's how God's life-changing movement happens. So at Waterline, we started telling people about Jesus, and we still are. We're just telling people about Jesus. That's what this morning is. It's our opportunity to tell you about Jesus. And when you hear about Jesus and it changes your life and you experience it, you're going to go tell somebody else. We know that. We know that there's going to be a desire in your heart. And Paul's the same way. Paul's living in a town called Ephesus. He started a church there. Started a church in Corinth. That's how we get the books of Corinthians and Church of Ephesus. He's Ephesus where he's at. And that's how we get the letter from Ephesians. He's writing letters to these churches. And he's showing them how to be church and how to reach people for Jesus. That's the whole goal of the church, is to go make disciples. And so he's in the city of Ephesus. And he begins to hear about Christians in Rome. And the Christians in Rome are being really persecuted. Really, really persecuted. That's what Christians do. We live differently. We see the world differently. And so our priorities are different. And the things that we value are different. And how we live our lives and how we love others and how we love God. All those things are different. And these Christians in Rome are being persecuted for that. Some of them are even being martyred for their faith. For their faith. And not only are they being martyred for their faith and are being persecuted, but they're also being kicked out of town. They're being dispersed. They're thrown out. They're getting rid of them. And so they're moving to all these different places in the Roman world. And Paul has this desire, this deep, deep desire to take the gospel of Jesus Christ to the ends of the earth. And for Paul, the ends of the earth is going to be Spain. That's where he's in it. That's where he's headed. That's where he wants to go. That's where he feels God is telling him, go towards Spain. And so to get to Spain, he's got to get to Rome. He's got to go to Rome. Now, there's threats on Paul's life. People have threatened to kill him for what he's preaching, and what he's telling people, what he's saying, what he's claiming about Jesus Christ. There's threats on his life. And not only that, I believe that the Holy Spirit is already preparing him, saying, your life is short. Your life is short. And so Paul sits down and he writes a letter to the Roman Christians around the church and in all the churches and all the areas. And we call it the Book of Romans. But it is literally Paul's Hail Mary to every Christian that will ever hear the gospel. He's trying to get it all the way to Spain and further. He knows that if I'm going to die, then I better write down everything that the gospel is. I better write down who Jesus is and how he can change lives and how he has changed lives. And what does it mean to be the church? What does that actually look like? And so as a pastor, as a Christian, I'm constantly going to Romans and I'm reading Romans. And especially as I lead this church, like how do we do this? How do you love God and love others in a modern culture? Well, Paul writes it down. It is his Hail Mary. He says, I'm going to throw this as far as I possibly can. I may not ever get there myself, but if I could just get this message to Waterline, in Hamilton County, Fishers, Indiana, it will still change lives. They've got to know about Jesus. And so that's what the Book of Romans is. It's a Hail Mary to every single Christian, every single church in the known world. And Paul writes it like this. He gives us some instructions on how to be the church. And this is an I Love My Church Sunday, which I absolutely love talking about this because I do love my church. You guys have been amazing. And so what we do on I Love My Church Sunday is I just give you a little look at where we're going for the next 4 or 5 months. What's our focus? What is it that we hope to accomplish for the Lord? But let's go to Romans chapter 15. We're going to be in verse 1. It says, We who are strong ought to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. And I like that verse. I think it's just a great reminder to every single person here that if you're here today, you are strong. Yeah. I mean, you got to worship the Lord. You got to pray together. You got to take communion together. You are strong. You might feel weak. You may not feel like the best spiritual person in the whole world, but you are strong because there's a whole bunch of people. There's actually 35,000 people who live within 2.5 miles of this place. And a rough estimate, but a pretty good estimate, is that 30,000 of them do not go to church at all. And I've just got to assume that if you don't have a desire to go to church, that maybe you don't have a desire or even a knowing to know who Jesus is, that if you really knew who Jesus was, you'd be here this morning. You'd be in one of those churches this morning. So those 30,000 people, I want to tell them about Jesus. And who's going to tell them? Paul reminds us, you're the strong. You're the ones who know Jesus. You're the one who has the gospel. You're the one. You're the strong ones. And so we exist in this church for those who aren't here yet. Can I get an amen? Amen. You can applaud for that. Absolutely. Absolutely. Paul writes here, you ought to. Like, it's your responsibility. You are not the church unless you, the strong, are living for the weak. That's what we're here for, because there's a lot of people who need hope, need joy, who need peace, and we just know they need Jesus. And how many of you say, I need Jesus? Absolutely. I know you. And you know me. And you know that boy needs Jesus big time. I need Jesus big time. Here's verse 2. Each of us should please our neighbors for their good, to build them up. For even Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the insults of those who insult you have fallen on me, Jesus said. For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in the scriptures and the encouragement they provide, we might have hope. I love that. Through the scriptures and through today's teaching, I hope gives endurance to your faith, gives encouragement to your faith, that you walk out of here and you're like, all right, let's go. Let's go Monday. Bring it on. Bring on Monday. But there's a lot of people who live in our community and they don't have that endurance. They don't have that encouragement. We have that. We're the strong. And so Paul's telling us, if you're the strong, then you need to live for the weak. This isn't a holy huddle where we get to come together and pat each other on the back and how you doing, how you doing, how you doing. I love doing that. I love doing that. In the 9:30 experience, I released everybody to go communion. I was sitting up here in the front row and I just started seeing my friends, my church. I'm hugging people and I thought, oh, I got to stop doing this because they're going to think this is a hug line. And people who don't want to get hugged are going to be like, forget this, I ain't going to get communion. So I had to stop hugging. You just tell people, how you doing, how you doing. I love this church. And if it were just us, I'd be cool with it. But that's not what God's called us to. That's not what I'm living for. And that's not the church I want to pastor. I love that I get to pastor this church. I know you hear me say that all the time, but I really do, because you're a church that exists for those who aren't here yet. Verse 5, may the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind toward each other that Christ Jesus had, so that with one mind, everybody say one mind, and one voice, everybody say one voice, you may glorify God the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ. See, we're better together. We are. My faith is stronger. We can experience God better. That's what the church is for. That's what Jesus started. A church that through his power was going to change the world. We are better together. Better together. Accept one another then, just as Christ accepted you, in order to bring praise to God. For I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the Jews on behalf of God's truth, so that the promise made to the patriarchs might be confirmed. And moreover, that the Gentiles, everybody say Gentiles, because that's us, we're not Jews, we're Gentiles. So that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles, I will sing the praises of your name. Again, it says, rejoice you Gentiles with his people, that's us. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles. Let all the people extol him or praise him or worship him. Let all the people, let every single Gentile, every single person who doesn't know Jesus Christ, know Jesus Christ. See, phase one, Jesus comes for the Jews. Phase two, Jesus establishes his kingdom here on earth, the church. And now we share it. We share it. And Jesus even told his disciples, he said, I've done all these miracles and all these great things through the Holy Spirit in my life, and I'm leaving you with that. You can have the Holy Spirit so that you can do miracles and you can move mountains and you can do big things. And Jesus said, I'm coming back for you. I'm going to go prepare a place, eternity for you, because I love you. You're my people, but you are the new humanity. You are going to be the ones through the Holy Spirit that reaches lost people, that reaches the weak. You're going to be me for the rest of the world. You're going to be my church. Verse 13, and this is where I want to settle today. It's so full of good things. It says this, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of his Holy Spirit. Let me break this apart a little bit so we can understand it and know where God wants to lead our church. Last summer, took the kids down to Florida, and I was going to show you this 3-minute video of my kids experiencing the waves in Florida, but I know how it is when I'm watching other people's videos of their kids and how boring that is and how I just don't care. So I watched it on your behalf, like twice, and I was happy and laughing and looking at my kids. But I watched it for you. But basically, the video is this. I took these two white, pasty Indiana kids down to Florida to the beach. And when those white Hoosier children, Indiana pasty kids, saw the water, they're like, waves, ah! They ran towards the waves, and then the waves started, and they ran back from the waves, and then ran towards the waves, and ran back the waves. Dean, he was so afraid of the waves and the power and the just the beauty of them. He didn't know what to do. He just rode his bike on the beach and into the waves. Like, he just rode his bike into the waves. We had to throw away the bike. But it was just, he didn't know what to do. He didn't know what to do with the waves. And I became fascinated with the waves. Waves are interesting, right? They're beautiful. Maybe that's because I'm from Indiana and the only waves we see is in my bathtub, okay? And so I was fascinated with the waves, and I apologize because some of you are picturing me in a bathtub, and I just want to say I'm sorry for that. That won't happen again. That won't happen again. Like, I can't even, I'm leaving now. This is terrible. What have you done to us? Waves are interesting, and let me just break down the science. If you were in earth science in third grade, you'll remember some of this. But this is the science of a wave. The water doesn't actually move. The water stays in the ocean. It doesn't actually move. But what happens is the current of wind, the wind currents, come down over the ocean or a pond or a river or whatever, and it comes down, and as the energy in that wind is moving through the wind, it's using the wind, it's moving through the wind, that energy, it's called kinetic energy, actually transfers from the wind into the water. Isn't that amazing? And that water now holds the energy, and that energy moves through the water like it did the wind, and it creates currents, deep, deep currents, but it also creates waves. And what happens with a wave is that a wave is moving, and the energy is moving through the water, and the water is rolling up over itself like a snowball. And it rolls up and it moves on and rolls up and it moves on and rolls up and it moves on. And the water comes back out and the wind pushes, kinetic energy moves through it. And the energy always moves out. It doesn't move to a center. It moves to out. That's how a wave is formed. It's interesting to me because when I read this scripture in Romans chapter 15, verse 13, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him so that you may overflow. Everybody say overflow. Overflow. Say overflow. Overflow. Say it like it's the last word of your life. Overflow. That's how Paul probably wrote it, because it probably was some of the last words of his life. And he wanted you to get this. He said, you will overflow like a wave with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. It starts with God and it ends with God. You're just the conduit in which God loves to move through. He loves to move through you. Names are interesting. Names are so interesting. A few weeks ago, we did child dedications up here. Families brought their children, dedicated them to the Lord. And one of the things that our church does is we love your name. Your name is a powerful thing because your name, I think, has a meaning. And what we like to do is we like to link that name with some scripture, like a life verse that you could carry from a child all the way up through an adult and say, I believe this is what God could use me for, what God wants to do in my life. And so we all wear name tags. And for these little children that we were dedicating, they're so stinking cute. And we've researched the name, meaning, and linked it to a life verse. Waterline had a different name when we first started. It did. It wasn't always called Waterline. And maybe you're wondering what Waterline means. Well, we had a different name. It was actually called Watermark. And I remember we had our very first launch team meeting. We called them the Dream Team. And these people came together, some of them brand new Christians, some of them been Christians for a long time, but they came together and said, what would it look like in our community? Because there's thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people who are not going to church. Why aren't they going to church? It doesn't mean that the churches we have in our community are bad or not good or not doing their job or anything like that. It's just that there are certain churches that reach certain people. And if you want to reach everybody, you got to start lots of churches with lots of different flavors and lots of different cultures and lots. But we all have the same goal. We all got the same goals, to make disciples, go make disciples. So we thought, what would it be for us to love God and love others? What would this look like? And what would this mean for our community? And I told them the name of our church was going to be Watermark Church. And when I introduced the name of the church, I had it scheduled, so our website went live. All right, so our website went live, and it had our vision on there, and what we want to do, and what we want to accomplish. And the vision of Waterline has never changed, even when we had to change our name. The vision was the same, but the meaning of our name had to change. And I remember that was a Sunday night, 6:30. The website went live. And the next morning, Colin, I got a call from a lawyer. And it's never good. I'll just let you know that right now. It's never good. They're not calling to see how you're doing. They were calling because there was a church called Watermark in Dallas, Texas. And they had planted in Denver, planted in Tampa. And they might someday, who knows, want to start a church here in Fishers, Noblesville, Indiana, and we couldn't have that name. It was trademarked. So there's trademark. I had to change the name. I remember hanging up the phone going, what am I going to do? I can't change the name. This name has meaning and vision and all this stuff that was wrapped up in it. And so I took it back to the dream team. I was like, guys, we got to change the name. But I told them this. I said, if we can change the name now, I think God's setting us up because we're going to have to change how we do things in the future. And we'll just always be known as the church that's ready to try anything. We'll be the church that's ready to change anything. Hey, we'll change our name if it's going to reach more people for Jesus. We don't care. We don't care what the name is. And my mentor said, John, seriously, nobody cares about the church name. It's just a name. And no one will, they'll just associate with you. And they, you know what I mean? You can call it Brown Church. And people come to Brown. They just don't even know. It doesn't matter. So what do? We called it Waterline Church. Well, let me show you the logo of Waterline Church because it does have a meaning. The vision is still the same. We want to reach people who are far from Jesus, lead them into a fully developed relationship with him. But you see those little waves down there? The artist put those on there, and we just kind of were like, oh, they're just cool waves because it's waterline, so that makes sense. But there is a meaning to them. There is a meaning. The meaning is that when you go under the water for baptism, you're putting your old self, your old life is put to death. And when you come up out of that water, it's a symbol, it's a sacred action. This baptism coming up out of the water, and you're reborn and new birth and new beginning, all given to the Lord. And the Lord is control of your life, and the Lord is the Lord of your life, and you're declaring that. And so we just kind of, that was the meaning that we have for those waves. And we took the name Waterline, we just kind of set it on a shelf. And a couple years ago, the Lord kind of called me back and said, John, there's something here for you. I've been meaning to tell you. A vision for where this church is going to go and what this church is all about. And that's what captured my attention about the waves. I mean, this was an artist thing, but there's more to it there, I think. I think God wanted to speak to us through it. And when this Romans chapter 15, 13 says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him. And how do we trust in him as a church? Here's four ways that we trust in God. Write these down in your follow along guide because you're going to see these this year. You've already seen the first one. The first one is, number one, we're going to consecrate ourselves. We're going to become fully dependent upon God in everything that we're doing. We're going to make plans that are way bigger than us. Way bigger than us, but we're going to trust the Lord. We're going to consecrate ourselves to what God wants to do. We just started this year with 21 days of prayer. 21 days of prayer where we just said, before we make any plans for the next 2017, we just want to be on our faces before the Lord, seeking him, saying, Lord, what do you want to do with us? What do you have for us? What's your will for us? We want to be dependent upon him. We want to know what God wants to do. So we're going to consecrate ourselves. And you're going to see opportunities for prayer in this church. Opportunities for you. I hope you say, okay, let's consecrate this church. And Lord, you got all this. You got all this equipment. You got us and all of our talents and treasures and everything. We just want to consecrate it all to you. Give it to you. That's how we trust the Lord. The second thing is we want to have courage to go for it. Courage. To be creative and say, hey, look, we're 6 years old. So we're like a toddler church. We're like kind of like, let's try something. Let's jump off something. Let's try something. Let's do something we've never done before. Let's think creative. Let's have courage to say, we're going to do that. We're going to go for that because those people matter and we love those people and we love God and he's calling us to go and do whatever we can. What's our Hail Mary? What is it that we're going to put everything on the line and say, let's be creative. Let's reach this community for him. Here's a third thing. We're going to be curious. We're not going to go into this with just as fools. We're going to have wisdom. We're going to be curious. We're going to learn as much as we can. We're going to become innovative. We're going to talk to the best in the church, and we're going to say, what are you guys doing? What are you doing? We're going to learn from what's going on. We're going to become innovative. We're going to try new things. What about in our grow plan? I love that our grow plan has these classes, and I get to hang out with everybody. But sometimes your schedule's busy. We got to make it different. We got to change it up a little bit so that more people can grow spiritually. We're not going to lose who we are about being highly relational. Everything is built on relationships at this church. But what could we do to be curious, to learn something, to grow as a church? And the last one is celebrate by giving our best. Celebrate. I want to be an excellent church. We do excellent ministry in this church. I am so proud of our team. And we celebrate a lot at this church. We celebrate all the time. And the reason why is because every single volunteer, wave maker, and leader in this church is they're giving their all to the Lord. They're giving their all to the Lord. They're putting it all on the line. And when we go in the locker room at the end of the game, we say we gave it, whether we failed or whether we won, we're giving it all to the Lord. And we can celebrate that. We can celebrate that and know what we're going to celebrate. And so when I look at what this is saying about, hey, when God's going to fill you, like kinetic energy filling a wave. God is going to fill this church. He's going to do big things. I think we need to remember we have one focus in this church, and don't forget this. We have one focus, and here's what it is. Number one, go make disciples. Number two, go make disciples. Our third focus, go make disciples. And our fifth, 500th focus is always going to be go make disciples. We got one focus of this church, and it's the focus that Jesus gave us. Go make disciples, he said. I want you to go to Jerusalem, then Judea, then Samaria, and to the ends of the earth, or what we call Hamilton County, Indiana. And we'll go beyond that if we can. Where else and who else's lives can we introduce Jesus to and share this gospel with? That's what we want to be a part of. But there's five waves, and I think which God moves his spirit through. Five waves of Waterline. You ready for these? I want you to write them down. Because you're going to see these, and I want you to participate in these. I want you to experience these. Kind of like when I had my kids, I took them to the ocean. And I said, all right, it took us 16 hours to drive here, plus all the bathroom breaks, plus all the meals. So we have been on the road for 6 months to get to this beach. I want you in those waves. I want you to experience it. I want you to love every minute of it. Because it took us a long time to get here. But there's five waves I think the Lord moves through in this church. Number one, he moves through our worship. I'm grateful for Chris and Kylie and the leaderships they've given this house band and all the new voices that you've seen up here, all the new songs we've been learning. But our worship doesn't end right here at the end of this stage. There is worship that is happening when people are glorifying God, when you're singing, when you're singing, when you're praying, when we're growing together through Scripture. That's worship. And I want to see more people worshiping the Lord. And not just other people I don't know. I want to see people who are in my life, who I've written their name down on this little card. Those are the people that I want to know who Jesus is, to experience that joy and peace that Christ gives, and it changes their lives. If my life is being changed, I desperately want other people's lives to be changed. We worship in this church. That's the number one thing we do at this church. So we worship God week in, week out. We come together to glorify him, to make his name famous. I'm so excited about this new series that we're going to start into, Lion Chasers. I really want to preach it right now, but I'm not going to. I'm going to wait till next week. But please come back next week, not for me, and not to hear the series, but to worship the Lord. My fear is that if you're not here worshiping the Lord, where are you worshiping the Lord? Are you worshiping him? The average attendance in the United States for going to church, for people who regularly go to church, is once every 8 weeks. That's six times a year. I think we can change that. I think we should change that. I think we can call people to say, what would it look like for you to worship the Lord, to designate a time and a place in your life and say, this is when I worship the Lord. So I want to see more people worshiping the Lord. Here's number two, a generous investment. Generous investment. Now all of you have talent somewhere in your life. You're good at something. I don't know what it is, but you have treasure. God has given you some resources. Who knows what you have? You have resources and you have time. And we all got the same amount of time, no more and no less. And those three things, I believe, are completely 100% God-given. You didn't get them. They were given to you by God. By God. He's your provider. He gives you provision, everything in your life for those three things because he wants your life to glorify him. And then we invite you as your church to invest it. Where are you going to invest those three things? I got to tell you about John. My buddy John, this week, he actually pull out your Love Wanted ad there on your chair. This is so cool. I had our team put this together for you because you're probably wondering, okay, I want to make an investment. Where do I make an investment in this church? Well, look it over. These are some areas that we need some love. So love God and love others. And then on the back here, you can put your name and your number, and then you can drop it in the back, or you can email Pastor Seth down there. But it's just some ideas here. One is this flag setter. Can I point out that one for you? John was invited to be one of our flag setters, and he came over to the building this Friday, and it's powerful to put out these flags because almost every single week someone comes in because they saw the flags on the road. It's pretty amazing how those reach people, and we're just putting them out there. And here's how it works if you're not a flag setter. Here's how it works. It just wasn't communicated very well, I guess. I don't know, but basically there's these spikes. Everyone say spikes. I want you all to be flag setters, so I'm telling you how to do it. You take the spike and you pound it into the ground, and then you take those big blue banners and they pop onto the spike. That's how it works, okay? And you can look at it on your way home. You're like, there's a spike right there. Well, John didn't get the memo. And so he shows up and he's got the big blue banner, but he doesn't have the spikes. Well, at least the spikes were there. He just didn't know that they go together and that they go in the ground. So what does John do? And if you don't know John, he's not in this experience. John has arms as tree trunks. I mean, the man is huge. I did their marriage coaching before they got married this past year, him and Mallory. And the whole time I was asking questions, I was just staring at his arms because they're so freaking big. I mean, they're just huge. And so I asked him at the end of that, how do you get arms like that? Because I really want to go home with arms like that to my wife. And he told me how, and I haven't been able to figure it out. So he dug a hole. He dug a hole because he couldn't find the spikes. He dug a hole and he planted the flag in the ground, frozen earth, so that people could know about Jesus. I mean, come on, that's pretty awesome right there. You can celebrate that. Absolutely. Absolutely. He invested time and energy. He made an investment. And you might be like, hey, people see those signs. You don't realize the what went in to put those up. Now, it's not really not that hard. You just pound a stake in the ground. But and he learned. He's not going to do that next time. Unless he has arms like that. He might just do that. Just like, and just nail him into the ground. I don't know. He can do that. I'll come watch. But there's an investment that you make. And you say, well, I'm not really that great with children. You're probably not. You're probably not. But anybody can pass out a snack, and anybody can sit next to a kid and say, how can I pray for you? Or how can I help you find this in the Bible? Or let's watch this together. Anybody could do something for the Lord. And so I want to invite people in, because when you're a part of this, you can celebrate this. You can be with us as we trust the Lord. If you're just coming and chilling and sitting, we're so glad that you're here. Welcome. But after a certain period of time, we want you to get off your butts and do something. Because why? It doesn't help me any. It doesn't change my life. It'll change your life. And anybody who's ever been a wave maker at this church, a volunteer at this church, has experienced God change their life through serving. I can't get them to stop serving. They'll show up and do it without me. And they do all the time. They'll show up here. They'll do it without us. So like yesterday, Tyler was here doing all this and getting all this ready for us. I mean, it's pretty amazing what this team does. Now let's go on. Number three is relational connections. We can never lose this Waterline. This is a wave. This is a wave in which the Holy Spirit moves in this church, is our relationship with one another. And I love our life groups. They are so, so powerful in building those relationships. And if you're not connected in a life group, it's going to be hard to get connected in this church. That's just the honest truth. And so we create these relational connections so that you can have friendships in the faith. And tell them. You could tell them, couldn't you, Nellie, how powerful your life group is. It's family. It is family, and you're there with one another. It's so powerful. And so I want you to have these relational connections. We want to create those relational connections on Sunday as well. We want to amp it up in 2017. And, you know, we've been doing we had a hot chocolate bar, and we had the popcorn bar, and we're going to have a cupcake bar next week. And then 3 weeks after that, we're having a tequila bar. I'm just joking. I'm just kidding. And sometimes I feel like that's where it's headed. Like, guys, I don't know if we should be going down this road. This is a slippery slope. And so, but we have all the, what we don't want to just feed you. And we like it when you eat because you seem so happy about that. But we don't want to just feed you. We want to get you together so we're having friendships and we're having conversations. We're not just coming in and rushing off. We want to be a church that cares about each other. And here's the fourth thing is life change. Life change happens when you experience God, but also you grow in wisdom. You grow in knowledge. You grow in stature. And so through the Grow Plan, those three classes, Roots 101, we're doing that today. We want to see your life change. It's going to come through your own life experiences, but when we can give you the knowledge of Scripture and the knowledge of who God is, and then you live out life and you run through that experience, and then every single week you are worshiping the Lord and coming back to Him and glorifying His name, you will be amazed at how God changes your life. Here's number five. It's a personal invite. And I'm going to invite Mike to come on up here because he's going to share his testimony with us. Super excited about this. Invite my friend Mike up, but here's number five, a personal invite. Personal invite. The very first Sunday at Waterline, and we've done it often at Waterline, is we invite people to identify someone in their life that doesn't know Jesus. But if they knew Jesus, it would change their life. And you might not say, you might say, John, I'm not an evangelist. I don't know how to share my faith all that well. And we have workshops throughout the year of how to share your faith. We want to teach you how to do that so you don't depend on me. But listen, I'll be the deal closer, okay? You bring them here and we'll sing and we'll pray and they'll get to curiously see and they'll be sit comfortably. I'm so grateful for our refreshments team. They just make this place so comfortable and gives us all caffeine. I just love it. But they'll come here and we'll tell them about Jesus. This might be the best opportunity for them to hear about Jesus, for you to sit with them and invite them in, to make an investment in their life, but to invite them in and say, join me at this experience because you're going to hear about Jesus. That happened in Mike's life. I love this story. I'm just going to read Romans chapter 15, verse 13 again. It says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Mike, thank you so, so very much for sharing your testimony this morning. Let me give you this, and let's listen to Mike's story.
Good morning. I guess it's afternoon now. So good afternoon. My name is Mike Schmidt. I'm here with my family, my wife Sally, and almost my whole family, my oldest daughter, Janie, and her younger sister, Abby. We have an older son who's away at school. John called me on Tuesday and invited me to share my testimony today. And to be completely honest, I didn't even really know what a testimony was. And we talked about it a little bit, and he gave me some guidance, and he said the first thing he wanted me to do was to come up with a word to describe my life before Jesus. And when he first asked me, I immediately thought I wasn't worthy. And so I prayed about the word and talked to my family about it. And the word I came up with was my life was unfulfilled. So for as long as I can remember, I've always believed in God. I considered myself a good person. I always tried to do the right things. I worked hard and was always considered a success by those who knew me. I went to church nearly every week. When I thought about God, which I have to admit wasn't very often, it was always in times of my wants or my needs. I believed that if I did enough of the right things, that I would certainly get into heaven. I had a great marriage, and I had three awesome kids. I had many of the material things that I'd worked hard to obtain. And every time I achieved something, I expected that to lead to happiness. You know, I've had hardship in my life. In 2005, I moved my family to Florida to start a restaurant company. And things were going great. And then the recession hit, and the real estate market crashed, especially in Florida. And many businesses were failing. And we were forced to sell our restaurants for next to nothing. So when that happens, usually you have debt. So we certainly had debt and have debt. But God gave us the opportunity to move to Indiana and kind of rebuild our life. So I had a great opportunity here. You know, my kids were in schools here and were doing well. Well, as 2016 started, my job started getting more and more stressful. This led to self-doubt. The stress continued and got worse, actually, over the last 3 or 4 months. I found myself uptight and easily agitated. At this time, I'd like to have my oldest daughter, Janie, come up and join me. Some of you may recognize Janie. She was here on January 8th and talked to you about the organization Crew. She's a senior at Fishers High School. She's had so many wonderful spiritual mentors. Janie has a wonderful relationship with one of the crew leaders named Deborah Foxworth. Janie's faith is so strong, it truly amazes me. She's been to numerous fast break retreats, and this past summer, she went on a crew mission trip to Spain and walked 100 miles of the El Camino de Santiago. On January 7th, which was a Saturday, we were getting my son Jack ready to go back to school. My wife, Sally, suggested that we go out to breakfast. I was in a world of stress that morning. I was anxious, worried, and uptight about my job. What should have been a great morning with my family wasn't. I was present at breakfast, but I really wasn't there. During breakfast, I pulled out a prayer that I had been reading about stress. And part of the prayer said, "Trust and love God and know that He will heal this stress just as the sun rises each day against the dark of night." I showed this prayer to Sally, and she reminded me that we're eating breakfast at the Sunrise Cafe. Earlier that week, Janie had handed Sally 3 cards to give to me. She told her that one night she couldn't sleep, and she spent 3 hours writing down Bible verses that she wanted me to read. I really didn't do anything with them. The 3 cards were, one was about stress, one was about marriage, and the 3rd one were her favorite Bible verses. I have those 3 cards right here with me today. After breakfast, we went home, and we got our son on the road back to school. Janie and my other daughter, Abby, were joking around and want us to have a group hug. But I was in my own world of anxiety and stress, and I walked right past them, not even really aware of what they wanted to do. Sally asked me, you know, what was wrong with me? So I was in my home office wondering, you know, what was becoming of my life. I was a ball of stress all the time. At that moment, something prompted me to grab my Bible and the 3 cards that Janie had given me and go upstairs and talk to her. I think she was a little surprised to see me carrying a Bible. I apologized and I asked her if we could talk about her faith. We ended up talking for nearly 2 hours. We talked about my job and the stress that was creating in my life. I showed her the prayer with the word sunrise in it while we were at the Sunrise Cafe. I also showed her an email message that I had sent to my team at work that morning. For the last 8 years, I've sent a daily message to my team, and that morning I addressed the message God morning rather than good morning. And you may think, okay, that's just a typo, but I've been doing that for 8 years, and I can never remember doing that. And Janie looked at me, and she said, "Dad, don't you understand what's happening?" And I said, "No, what?" And she said, "God is talking to you." And she said that without any doubt in her mind. During our conversation, she received a text message from Deborah asking her to come to a church the next day and talk about crew. Well, that church was Waterline. That Sunday, John talked about an experience he had when he was in college, where his mom was sick and he was angry. He found himself in a park. And just finally, after he settled down, he just stopped and listened to God. And that was his message that day, was learning how to listen to God. And that's what Janie was telling me was happening in my life. She also suggested that we go and talk to Deborah. So later that Sunday afternoon, Janie, Deborah, and I went through a booklet called Connecting with God. We talked for nearly 2 hours. Toward the end of the discussion, she asked me if I wanted to say a prayer giving my life to Christ. And I said yes. The prayer was this: "Lord Jesus, I need you. Thank you for dying on the cross in my place for my sins. I believe in you, and I open the door of my life and receive you as my Savior and Lord. Thank you for forgiving my sins and giving me eternal life. Take control of the throne of my life and make me the kind of person that you want me to be." She also wanted me to meet John. And the next day, John called me and we set up a time to meet. John and I have met a couple times since then, and I'm truly grateful for his spiritual mentorship. Since that Saturday, God has continued to remind me that he is with me. And the word that I came up with to describe my life after I gave it to Christ was surrender. And this is not easy for me. I still struggle to truly surrender to his will and to give my life over to him and understand that he has a plan for me. But when I do give myself the chance to do that, I feel a peace come over me that I'm not accustomed to. So I just really want to thank Janie because she really led me to Christ. And I want to thank you, John, for asking me to do this. It was truly a privilege. Thank you.
Hang on 1 second. I live for those stories. So this church lives for those stories. And I hope you heard it. That God was doing something in Janie's life, and she shared it with her dad. That's a big deal. It's a really big deal. I'm proud of you, Janie. Pastor Janie. Pastor Janie. I believe that the Lord moves in us like a wave. He moves in the water line. And He fills the water line with all that He is. Joy and peace and so much more. And as we trust in Him, Paul tells us, we will overflow by the Holy Spirit. And throughout all that story, that I kept hearing the Holy Spirit moving, interacting with our lives, because there's nobody who loves Michael more than Jesus Christ. And He used Janie to speak to Michael. We got to be a part of that. I love being a part of that. The Lord's going to move through you. I believe to somebody else, if you're willing. If you're willing, write a name down. If you're willing, dedicate your life for those who aren't here yet, because you're the strong. You're the strong. We exist for those who aren't here yet, to be a movement of people, a water line that loves God and loves others. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank You for this church. I am honored to be their pastor. I'm honored that I get to call this my home church. I'm honored for what You want to do in our lives. And I just ask, God, that You would give this church more opportunities. As we prepare ourselves, and as, Lord, as we seek You and consecrate our lives to You, would You give this church more opportunities to reach more people for You? Lord, that's why we're here. And so with all of our time and talent and treasures, God, we're going to dedicate it to You, focusing it, Lord, on making disciples so that we can experience You in the overflow of life, in the overflow, God. Let this church overflow with love. Let this church overflow with love. Let this church overflow with love. We love You. And all of Waterline said, amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Waterline, for being here this Sunday. Come back next week. Bring a friend with you for Friend Day. Grab an invitation before you leave. Next time we meet together, the Falcons will have won the Super Bowl. I'm having faith. Have some faith. Have some faith. I love you, Waterline. We will see you next week. Hey, to all of our friends who are watching online, welcome to the journey. At Waterline, we believe that everybody's on a spiritual journey. What we want to do is journey with you. If today's talk spoke to you in any way, would you please let us know that? You can email us at WTLN@waterlinechurch.com. Share with us your story. One of our pastors would be excited to connect with you. Thank you so much for watching and sharing this message online. Continue to share it around to your friends and family members as we continue to grow together and change the world.